Okay, last week we were almost done with the clay cutting. And we ended, I think, about with this slide. And we had one equation for the strengthening effect of clay, the strengthening of the cohesion, where specifically this was a constant. And here you have the strain rate or the deformation rate of the clay. In fact, in the lecture notes, I use an equation where I transform those strain rates into cutting velocities, so you can just insert the cutting velocity and that way calculate the strengthening effect. Then something important for clay, the cohesion is roughly six times the SPT value. You can find that in many soil mechanics books. So if you talk about soft clay to very hard clay, they have a range with SPT values for each category. And then you can see it's roughly six times the SPT value. But because the strengthening effect has a factor of roughly two, doesn't have to be exactly two, but roughly it's two, for us, the cohesion we will use is 12 times the SPT value, or two times the cohesion, the shear strength, you get from a laboratory. Yeah, so you can also get the shear strength from laboratory tests. You multiply it with a factor two, and that's what you can use in dredging. If you know everything, of course, you can use this equation to determine the exact factor, but because it's a logarithm, if we have, for example, cutting velocities of around 6 meters per second for a normal cutter head, and you would want to see the difference between 6 meters per second and 7 meters per second, then because of this logarithmical form, there is not much difference between 6 meters per second and 7 meters per second. So that's why we say in the range where we are normally operating, let's say 4 to 10 meters per second, somewhere in between, this factor could go from 1.8 to 2.1, something like that. Yeah, so roughly 2. Specific energy again, force times velocity is power, and layer thickness times the width of the blade times the cutting velocity is the production. So specific energy was defined as power, cutting power divided by the production. The dimension that I often use is either kPa in clay and sand or MPa in rock. But I also saw, right now we are busy with the minor deep sea, and there they have to do such calculations to determine the required power for hyperbaric rock cutting. And I saw many students, they use megajoule per cubic meter, which is exactly the same as MPa, yeah, if you look at the dimensions. So megajoule is meganewton meter. Meganewton meter divided by cubic meter is meganewton per square meter, which is megapascal. Yeah, so it doesn't matter which dimension you use. I like to use megapascal because it gives you the feeling, pascal is pressure, it gives you the feeling of how hard do I have to push against the material to make it collapse. But officially it's energy per cubic meter. Well, this was the equation where we derived from the force balance, where you have the sines and the cosines. So beta was the shear angle, alpha was the blade angle. Normally in dredging we have an alpha 50 to 60 degrees, mostly something like 55 degrees, and the beta in clay, well, I showed you a graph for many different cases, but if you have normal clay, what is normal clay? Let's say up to 50 kPa, which is the relatively soft clay. In that case, you also have a high adhesion. And then the beta would be 30 to 35 degrees, roughly. Yeah, it depends on the exact situation, but somewhere between 30 and 35 degrees. If I would have very hard clay with no adhesion at all, then the beta could increase to 40, 50 degrees, also depending on the situation. The Ka was the ratio between the adhesive force and the cohesive force. So it gives you a feeling of how much cohesion do I have. If I don't have cohesion at all, Ka is zero. But the Ka, because it's not the ratio between the stresses, it's the strengths, it's the ratio between the forces, because of that, Ka could be higher than one, bigger than one. Yeah, if you have a very long blade with a lot of adhesion and a very thin slice you are cutting, then the cohesive force is small and the adhesive force is big. And in such a case, the Ka could have a value bigger than 1. And here you see the 12 SPE, so SPT, so basically that's just the cohesive strength, the shear strength of the material. So this is how to determine the specific energy. Then we had some graphs for specific energy. Here you see the Ka values. I think in the lecture notes I used the R for this ratio, but basically it's exactly the same. So you can see this is a clay with low adhesion, this is a clay with very high adhesion. And then of course the higher the adhesion, the higher the specific energy. This is a production graph. I made it logarithmic because for clay you get nice straight lines if you make it logarithmic. Production per 100 kilowatts, so it's the equation from the previous page slide, but just reversed. So if I have 100 kilowatt, I know the SPT value, then here I can read the production in cubic meters per hour. And I made those graphs for 30 degree blade. Here you have 45 specific energy and production, and 60 degrees also the specific energy and the production. Yeah, so using those graphs, you don't even have to use the equations, you can just read where you are. Then we go to, and that's the things I still had to discuss, we go to the tear type. And now the question is, in the tear type in clay, and that could be different from rock, but in the clear tear type in clay, you will always get a tensile crack going a little bit downwards. Why is that? Well, according to the theory here, we would have a shear plane. If you have a shear plane, then you know at the shear plane the material is failing on shear, which is the top of the Mohr circle. If the material is failing in this plane based on shear, that means the lowest normal stress is probably on the negative axis, I will show you in the next slide, but it's 90 degrees from the top, right? So if it fails by shear at the top of the Mohr circle, then the principal stress, the smallest principal stress, is under 90 degrees in the Mohr circle, which is 45 degrees in reality. That means that this angle, so the angle between this shear plane and the tensile crack, is 45 degrees. And you can just look at the Mohr circle. But if you would have a material with some internal friction, in clay, normally we assume the clay does not have internal friction if you cut, because it's an undrained situation. But you could have a mixed soil, so clay with some sand in it. Yeah, in that case, it might have internal friction, and then this angle would not be 45 degrees, because that means the top of the failure point at the Mohr circle is not exactly at the top of the circle anymore. Yeah, so in that case, the angle would probably be smaller. Now, what does it look like, and how do we deal with it? Here you have a Mohr circle, and what do we have in this picture? First of all, here, this red dotted line is the shear strength of the clay, and this red dotted line is the tensile strength of the material. The real curve does not have to look so rectangular like I did it here. It could be a smooth curve going from this point in a curve to the shear to the failure line, but very often you don't know exactly how the what the curve looks like in this area. So that's why I just made it rectangular, because the only thing I'm interested in is the top, which is the shear strength, and here the vertical, which is the tensile strength. And I'm not really interested in what happens in between. Now, we can, based on the cutting theory, we can determine the normal stress, or the first you start with the normal force in the shear plane. And if you divide the normal force in the shear plane by the surface of the shear plane, you have your normal stress. Since it's the shear plane, so we assume that's where the material will fail by shear, it means the failure would be in this point, the top of the circle. That means the origin of the circle is the normal stress on the shear plane. Yeah, because on that shear plane you have one combination of normal stress and shear stress. So on the shear plane, this is the shear stress and this is the normal stress. And then if you know those two things, you can draw the whole circle. In this case, you can see the circle extends on the negative axis beyond the tensile strength. So if I would look at this point, yeah, the tensile stress in this point is much lower than the tensile strength over here. That means I will get tensile fracture. Yeah, so if you have such a case, you will get tensile fracture because your Mohr circle exceeds the strength of the material. Now, how to solve that? Because, you know, it's nice to know, oh, we will have tensile failure. Okay, very nice. But also in the case of tensile failure, I like to be able to determine the force. Yeah, because I'm still cutting and I still want to determine the cutting power. So what do I do? And you can do that with different methods. I just choose a method. What do? I reduce the normal stress on the shear plane, so the origin of the circle, I make it smaller and smaller. In fact, I make the radius of the circle smaller until the circle just touches the tensile strength. It means the whole circle is reducing until it touches the tensile strength. Well, that's this circle, circle 2. It means I have a much lower normal stress, because the normal stress is limited by the moment where I get a tensile fracture. Once I get that tensile fracture, the normal stress on the shear plane cannot become bigger anymore. Yeah, the only thing that will happen if I continue pushing the blade is that my tensile crack will increase in size. Yeah, so this would be the circle that I get matching the tensile crack. It just touches the tensile strength here. Well, if I can calculate this circle, and the equations are in the lecture notes, if I can determine this circle, then the top of the circle is the shear stress on the shear plane. Yeah, because in both cases, between this point and this point, you have 90 degrees. Also here, between this point, you have 90 degrees. So the angle stays 45 degrees between the shear plane and the tensile crack. This way I can determine the shear the shear stress on the shear plane, and if I can determine that stress, I can use exactly the same equations as with the flow type to determine the total cutting force. Yeah, so this is a way to determine how can I reduce the shear stress in the shear plane so that it matches tensile cracks. And that's what I use to determine cutting forces. This is the way to do that. Then, if you look at specific energy, because the previous graphs of specific energy that I showed you are all for the flow type, so they are all for the case where you don't really have tensile cracks. If I have tensile cracks and I work with this reduced shear stress, I can also calculate the forces, and that's what I do here. You also get the case where if I have a very thin layer of clay, I have much more adhesion. So a thin layer would have a higher specific energy than a very thick layer, and that's what you can see in this picture. Then we have the curling type, and the curling type was what we have if you have a thin layer of clay with a lot of adhesion. Yeah? So the normal stress in the shear plane is not strong enough to push the material all the way over the blade because the adhesive force is too big. In that case, it starts curling or it starts bending or buckling, but the material will never flow all the way over the blade, yep, just because the forces are not strong enough. In that case, what do we do? Well, we take the moment equation and we say, okay, in the shear plane, we know the cohesive force, and based on the cohesive force, we know the normal force. Yeah, we know that. So this normal force I can calculate from the normal cutting equations. I assume it's at 50% of the shear plane, so I can determine the moment based on that force. Here, we have the problem that we don't know over which distance the clay is in contact with the blade. We don't know that. And we would like to know what is that distance, because then we can calculate forces again, but we also know how it will start curling. So you can say, okay, we know a force N2, and this force N2, the normal force, is a function. It's related to the adhesive force, also to the shear force, the cohesive force, but also to the adhesive force. Now, the adhesive force is proportional to the length of the blade. So, what do? I create an equation with the adhesive force as a function of the length of the blade. Then, I take the equilibrium of moments, because I just have two moments, and this moment from the cohesive normal stress and here the normal stress on the blade, but in this N2 I have the height of the blade. So I just determine for which height would it give an equilibrium of moments, and that's the distance over which the clay will be in contact with the blade. Yeah, so once you have those forces, in fact we can do an exercise with that, because now maybe it seems complicated, but if you see the real equations for clay, it's not that complicated. So you can calculate the length over which the clay is in contact with the blade based on the equilibrium of moments of those two forces. That's it. And if that the blade length that you find is bigger than the actual blade length, it means it will be in contact with the whole blade. Yeah? Because you can't make a blade longer. Okay, that's the theory for today. So you can stop the recording now. Then you have an easy...